We have followed all the standards that are applicable.
There are no standards because we have no intimate knowledge of how Earth and life work together.
Many times we've experimented on various different things and then it didn't turn out the way we expected it to.
It can get as big as what's been determined to be safe in the environmental impact statement. It can't go any bigger than that.
The environmental impact statement was funded by the Air Force and the Navy, the people that are running the program.
When you look at the Earth itself, you think about the Earth and how it releases energy naturally. You can look at earthquakes and what we know about them over 30 years is they're increasing in depth, frequency, and magnitude. You can look at weather patterns. And what everyone knows, at least in this country and most of the world now, is weather patterns are going through dramatic shifts that are blamed on any number of factors. And you can also look at tidal heights in the North Sea, which have been steadily rising over a 30-year period as it's been charted. All of that indicates releases of energy. And then in the midst of this natural releases of energy, we're going to inject billions of watts of power into the magnetic lines of force. What this will do, they don't really know because they've never been at these power thresholds before.
Safety is the main consideration here. Aircraft safety, radio frequency safety. The environmental impact statement is the governing document. And anybody that has an environmental concern that we have not addressed in this should come to us and let us know about it.
There's no independent scientific committee looking at this outside of the military. There is no physiologist or bioscientist involved in this project from the military looking at those bio effects. We think it's a narrowly focused program in the sense that the bulk of it is military driven. That's what's driving the budgets and that's what's driving the program.
The military research is one line of work, and I would say the medical research is another line of work, and for most part these two groups are not talking to one another.
There are a number of scientists like myself who are concerned about this, who are in fear of what HAARP could do to the planet. Not only mind control, but weather changes, possible earth changes, earthquakes, things like that. And we all need to band together. We need to contact each other over the internet. We need to lead a discussion on this, and scientists need to contact their government representatives and tell them what they feel about this.
Our critics have talked about HAARP and some of the problems they perceive. If anyone, any group, individuals, whatever, were concerned, they're welcome to tour the site. They're welcome to put together an independent team of their experts to come onto the site and to review what it is we're doing. We have absolutely nothing to hide.
We need to bring in people from all walks of life to study the possible consequences of this technology. We don't know the effects. I don't think we should move blindly forward and just do these experiments.
We were recently invited to Brussels to speak to a group of parliamentarians in an organization called Global International. And we were able to present HAARP as an issue to over 60 parliamentarians from 40 countries. And what was important is it really was the first time many of these folks had heard much about this project. But I can tell you that the international interest has been growing. The scientific community is starting to wake up to the issue. And what we're seeing is more people willing to go forward and speak out.
I'm concerned that the people who understand that all life is interconnected aren't the people that are making the decisions about these experiments on our ionosphere.
What air I breathe, everybody else breathes. Water and air and the land are life. Let's do what we have to do to protect it.
As living systems, we're open systems, and we can't draw the line between where our boundary stops and where the boundary of the non-living domain begins. The Earth is a living organism. It's not something that's really outside of us. It's really an intimate part of who we are. And when we destroy it, we destroy ourselves.
I have always asked that if anybody has a problem, come and let us see what the problem is. And if it's something we haven't addressed that we should have, of course we'll address it.
The problem with government and the people right now is that people don't trust the government, and they have good cause not to, because so many times over the years they've not told them the truth.
Well, the planet's electrical system is not there for us to exploit for Department of Defense purposes. It's there as a part of a whole beautiful, harmonious, interconnected system that supports all life on this planet. And we don't know everything that there is to know about it.
It's not up to me to determine that it is or is not a valid expenditure of taxpayers' funds. That's not my, call. And if Congress gives us the funds, evidently they believe it's worthwhile. I'm told to do this, and we are doing it.
Those people who are in government, they tell me a lot of times that they're just following orders. My response is, so was Heinrich Himmler. He was just following orders.
We're about to embark on another arms race. It's totally unnecessary. We're committing billions of dollars to this technology, and the question becomes is, where does it end? I mean, we spent, they figured, $3 trillion on the entire nuclear adventure, and that's, you know, 60% of the current national debt. Are we going to start that cycle again? Is it necessary to do that again?
There's just no sense to make more of HAARP than there already is. It's intended to be for research, and that's all.
So even though HAARP is small today, it really, every major weapons program was small at its infancy. It's just we usually don't find out about them till 50 years later. In this case, we're finding out at the beginning phase, and this is a time for people to take and pay attention and look at this technology and determine, is this really a direction we want to go, and is it really necessary right now?
HAARP is not a threat, it's a benefit.
We also know that there are other very specific frequencies which are different from the war games frequencies, which can enhance healing, which can accelerate natural healing in our bodies, which can alleviate our mood disorders, which can help us get over depression, anxiety, and sleeplessness. The military has very different plans and asks different questions looking at the same system than the scientist who's interested in medical issues or healing the planet.
It may not be that the Earth will die, but we will not be able to sustain human life on this planet if we continue to add one element of destabilizing technology after another.
If we do not stand up for what we believe in, for the children, we're not doing our job.
Perhaps true wisdom lies in knowing our limitations and that even the laws of nature are uncertain. In view of these technologies, we're left to wonder, do these experiments jeopardize our long-term survival?